Hi, I'm Kathy Thomas. I'm a nurse. I work with the UK Department of Orthopedics, and I coordinate patients having joint replacements, hips and knees. I would like to welcome you to our pre-op hip class. I will give you a brief description of the surgery and then talk about getting ready for surgery, what to expect in the hospital, and then when you go home, taking care of yourself. One of our dietitians will talk to you all about the importance of diet and nutrition before and after surgery. And then at the end of class, one of our physical therapists is going to talk about physical therapy and occupational therapy after hip replacement surgery. So keep in mind that we're talking generally how things go. Of course, our care is going to be individualized, so things might be a bit different for you based on your history, how your surgery goes, even how your recovery goes. So by the end of class, you should know how to get ready for surgery, what your family needs to know, what to expect on the day of your surgery, and then how to return to normal activities. So usually by the time you're scheduled for surgery, you're attending class, usually people are limited in activities that they need to do or want to do. It's one of the reasons to have surgery. It's a quality of life surgery. So towards the end of class, we'll talk about getting back to those activities that you might be limited in now. So a little bit about hip replacement surgery. Main reason that hip replacement is done is for arthritis of the hip. Most common form of arthritis is osteoarthritis or degenerative joint disease. It's the wear and tear type of arthritis. So here in these pictures of a hip joint, you can see the pelvis, and then you can see the femur or the thigh bone. Head of the femur sits in what we call the acetabulum. And on the end of the head of the femur is a smooth covering of cartilage. Cartilage is like a shock absorber. As we walk, put force through our joints, it absorbs that force. Well, with arthritis, and particularly osteoarthritis, the cartilage gets worn away. So you can see in the picture on the left, the cartilage is rough, it's not smooth, there's a piece worn away, bone is showing through. Then in the picture on the right, more cartilage worn away, more bone showing through, inflammation in the joint. So when this person moves their legs certain ways, bone rubs on bone, that causes pain. That's going to limit our mobility because we don't like to be in pain. So what the surgeon does to correct this is total hip replacement. Now, it's not usually a jump straight to surgery kind of thing. Usually it's a progression of maybe nonsteroidal anti-inflammatory medications to help with the pain, maybe physical therapy to strengthen the muscles around the joint, maybe hip injections to help with the pain. And then when we get to the point that all else fails, we get to the point of surgery. And so what the surgeon does, and these are two pictures of the same thing, he will cut off the head of the femur since that's where the problem is. They make very precise cuts, they smooth out any rough bone, and then they replace that with a metal stem that goes in the femur that has a metal ball on the end of it. There's a metal cup that goes on the pelvis side that has a plastic liner. So that's what a total hip replacement looks like. And again, on the left, you can see what a total hip replacement looks like. On the right is an x-ray of a total hip replacement in place. You can see the stem that goes in the femur, the ball, the metal ball that goes on the end of it, the metal cup on the pelvis side. You can't see the plastic liner because it doesn't show up on x-ray. And the other thing about the x-ray is most hip replacements are held in place by what's called a press fit, which means a tight fit, both on the acetabulum side and the femur side. And you can see in the picture of the hip replacement that there's a rough coating on the stem and the cup. And so your bone, as you heal, will grow into that rough coating, and that's what holds it firmly in place. So on the x-ray, you can see one screw there. So usually they use at least one screw to hold the cup in place, keep it from moving while your bone is growing into that rough coating. The screw stays there. You don't know it's there, never has to come out. You will have an x-ray of your new hip in the recovery room. So if you want to see your hip replacement, let your surgeon know. They can show it to you either when you're in the hospital or when you come back for a follow-up appointment. So there are two different surgical approaches to doing hip replacement. And they're called posterior, where the incision is more towards the side or towards the back of your hip, and then anterior, where the incision is in the front. The surgeon is the one who decides which approach to use. They look at your x-rays, they look at your body shape, history of previous surgeries. All the surgeons close the underneath layers with reabsorbable suture, and then the skin layer is closed with either skin glue, which is like super glue for people, the brand name that we use is Dermabond, or staples, and then the incision is covered with a waterproof dressing. The incision on the left is closed with staples. That picture was taken a few days after surgery. The incision on the right is closed with glue. That picture was taken at a follow-up appointment 2 to 3 weeks after surgery over in the office. So you can see a big difference in the appearance of the incisions. When you're discharged, you will get specific information about how your incision is closed, when to take the dressing off, and when you can get in the shower. Now, bruising is normal after surgery. Bruising is also very individual. Not everyone is going to have this much bruising, but if you do, it is normal. Gravity pulls bruising around, so it is not unusual that it might go around the back, down the back of your leg, even to your ankle. Your body absorbs bruising like this, just like it does any bruise. Now, in this picture, you can see the glue on the incision because it gets white and flaky when it wears off, just like super glue does. And then the purple marks across the incision, they're markers that they use during surgery. They will wear off on their own. So now we're going to talk about getting ready for your surgery, your hip replacement surgery. And even though you've not had surgery yet, we want you to plan ahead for your discharge home. You will probably only be in the hospital overnight. That does not give you a lot of time to plan, so you need to plan ahead. If you live alone and you think that you need help when you go home, it's your responsibility to arrange for that ahead of time. Living alone is not a reason to go to rehab someplace like Cardinal Hill. The majority of our patients by far are getting around well enough that they're able to go home. It's only those patients who have a medical complication after surgery that would slow down their getting around that might qualify to go to rehabilitation. Now, we want you to think of your family or friends not as caregivers, but more as your coach. Because if you think about it, you're not really sick. You're coming in to get a new hip. So the coach's job is to help encourage you, motivate you, help with things around the house while you're focusing on your recovery. Another thing that we want you to think ahead and plan for is your outpatient physical therapy. All the surgeons that I work with prefer that you go to outpatient therapy, where you go out of your house 2 or 3 days a week for about an hour each time. Most patients go somewhere close to their home that takes their insurance. So we want you to go ahead and figure out where you're going to go for your outpatient physical therapy, call them up and set up your first post-op physical therapy appointment for 4 to 7 days after surgery. Depends on the day of the week that you're having surgery and how the weekend falls as to when you would schedule that. So schedule your first outpatient physical therapy appointment for after surgery before you come in, and then when you're discharged, you'll get the order for physical therapy that you take with you to that first appointment. Another thing that you need to think about and plan ahead for is transportation. You will need someone to drive you home from the hospital, and then probably to at least your first post-op appointment and your physical therapy appointments. And on the screen, you can see suggestions. I've had patients who've used all those as ways to get to their outpatient physical therapy and their follow-up appointments. And then think about any additional support that you might need, whether that be with meals, things around the house, care of pets. Have a plan for that ahead of time. So for 1 month to 1 week before your surgery, one of our dietitians is going to talk to you all about the importance of diet and nutrition before and after your surgery.
Hi, I'm Sarah. I'm one of the dietitians here at Good Samaritan. And during this segment, we're going to review nutrition in the days and weeks leading up to your procedure, as well as what to expect when you're in the hospital from a nutrition perspective. So it's important to remember that because you're here for a relatively short length of time, you may or may not see an RD during your admission. So if you do want to talk to a dietitian, feel free to let your nurse know. They can speak with your doctor, place a consult if needed. And there's also a phone number on your handout if you do have questions during your admission. You're welcome to call that as well. So I'll be referring to the sheet that you've got. It's titled Nutrition Therapy Before Surgery. And I want to start by just emphasizing the importance of a well-rounded diet. So we'll use the MyPlate image that's on the screen as a reference. And it's important for you to remember there's no need to try to do any sort of crash diets, anything out of the ordinary for yourself, like keto or trying to lose a bunch of weight. Those things aren't necessary and they're actually not beneficial to you before surgery. We just want you to look at a well-rounded diet as kind of your goal. And I do want to say, if you follow like a diabetic diet or a cardiac diet at home, something specific for your health conditions, please continue to do that. You don't need to alter that or stop doing that for any reason. So to review the MyPlate image there, generally speaking, a healthy diet is gonna be about half of your plate fruits and vegetables, about a quarter of your plate to be protein, and about a quarter of your plate to be grains, half of which we would ideally like to be whole grains. And we'll discuss the reason for that in just a minute. So it's really important during the time leading up to your procedure to try to get adequate protein in your diet. And by adequate, we mean roughly 3 ounces of protein at each meal. So 3 ounces is typically more than what most Americans are already getting. It's about the size of a deck of cards for reference. And so that should be your goal for each meal, is roughly 3 ounces of protein. That can be things like meat, which is typically what people think of, or it could be cheese, nuts, eggs, soybeans, yogurt, low-fat milk, tofu, and chickpeas if you're not really a meat eater. So any source of protein would be good. We just want you to try to get roughly 3 ounces at each meal. And so I do want to point out, you don't want to double your protein. It really isn't of benefit to you because your body can only process so much protein at one time. Roughly 20 to 30 grams of protein is what your body can process at one time. So doubling up doesn't really do anything for you as far as putting you at an advantage for your procedure. All that excess protein that your body doesn't process is typically excreted through your urine. And so it's kind of a waste of your effort to try to double on protein. So if you're able to eat the 3 ounces at each meal, that's wonderful. If not, there are also supplements, which we'll discuss here in a minute, that can be good to help you meet your protein needs if you're not able to eat them through your PO intakes, your meal intakes. And then the other important thing before your procedure is to try to get adequate fiber. So there are specific recommendations for men and women, at least 25 grams of fiber for women and 38 grams of fiber for men per day. And so some good sources of fiber are going to be your fruits and vegetables, beans, nuts, and whole grains. So that's why when we talk about the My Plate image, about a fourth of your plate is grains. We want half of those to be whole grains for the added fiber. And as you increase your fiber, we want to make sure that we're increasing our fluids as well. The reason for increasing your fiber before your procedure is because you're typically put on some medications which can contribute to constipation. And so by increasing your fiber intakes before your procedure, you're more likely to avoid that problem, or at least attempt to avoid that problem. So as you increase your fiber, make sure you increase your fluids, because sometimes when we increase the fiber too quickly, we actually cause constipation for ourselves. So just remember that, to increase your fluids as you increase your fiber. And then just avoiding, you know, really heavy meals, anything fried or like very sugary. And that's just kind of a general health recommendation, but before your procedure as well, we kind of want to avoid those things. And so moving on, we'll talk about your diet after surgery. So after your procedure, your diet will advance as tolerated. I do want to point out it's perfectly normal if your appetite is decreased after your procedure. It's also perfectly normal if you feel like you could eat a full meal after your procedure. It varies significantly from person to person. So if you do experience a decreased appetite, I wouldn't be concerned about it. It's completely normal. So your doctor will advance your diet as tolerated. And so the supplements that are listed here, these are Boost products. We carry Nestle products here in the hospital. But this is the supplements that I mentioned earlier. If you have a decreased appetite after your procedure, or you're having trouble meeting your protein needs at mealtimes, these can be really beneficial to you as far as meeting those protein needs. So in the hospital, Boost is what we have, and that's typically ordered after your procedure in case you experience a decreased appetite. But if you do need them at home, they don't have to be Boost products. They can be Ensure, there's Kroger and Walmart brands, Premier Protein. So those are all options for when you leave the hospital. And not everybody is necessarily going to need these. You might have a good appetite after your procedure, as I mentioned before, but they can be helpful if you feel like you have a decreased appetite or you can't meet your protein needs. And if you prefer Boost products, and you know, they can be kind of expensive. So if you need some help as far as that goes, your doctor can write a prescription for Boost products at a discounted rate. They're not free, but they're discounted, and you just have to pick them up here at the hospital pharmacy before you leave.
Thank you. So when you and your surgeon decided it was time to go ahead with surgery, he decided what consults he wanted in order to make sure that you're a good candidate for this elective procedure. It is elective, it's not an emergency. So depending on your health problems, you might need to see your family doctor or even a specialist for what we call a clearance. And that's for that doctor to do whatever tests or exams they feel they need to do in order to say what is your risk for having surgery and do they recommend proceeding or not. Everyone will have to come for a pre-admission testing appointment. This is one appointment, usually 2 to 4 weeks before surgery. You meet with the nurses who work with anesthesia. I kind of think of that appointment as a final check to make sure everything is in order. After that appointment, you'll have lab studies that your surgeon orders. Sometimes at that appointment, or even on the labs, something might come up that you're then asked for a clearance. But hopefully, since that appointment is 2 to 4 weeks before surgery, hopefully that's enough time that we can get things straightened out so that surgery doesn't have to be delayed. And then you might wonder, well, why would I need to see a dentist if I'm having my hip replaced? So one of the possible complications after hip replacement surgery is infection. And there is the possibility that if you have infection elsewhere in your body, bacteria could get in the bloodstream, travel, settle in the hip replacement. That's not a good thing if that happens. It can actually mean two more surgeries. One to take the hip out, you would get antibiotics through an IV for 6 to 8 weeks or until the infection is cleared up, and then another surgery to put another hip back in. So the surgeons are very careful about the risk of infection, and you can see why. If you are having any problems with a tooth or teeth, you need to see your dentist. Let them know you're scheduled for hip replacement surgery and see if they recommend proceeding or not. And the other thing that I would tell you if you need to see your dentist at this point before your surgery is please call my number, which is on the card in the front of your folder, and let us know what's going on so that we can let your surgeon know as well. Sometimes patients ask if they need to pre-donate blood for this surgery, and your surgeon does not recommend that. Our rate of transfusion is very low. It's 5% or less, and we do things to help decrease blood loss. If you use tobacco or nicotine products, though, your surgeon does want you to stop. We all know that smoking is not good for heart and lungs, but nicotine is a vasoconstrictor, which means it narrows the blood vessels. You don't get as good a blood supply to the tissues, and it can affect healing. So that's another reason that your orthopedic surgeon wants you to stop using tobacco and any nicotine products before surgery. You cannot shave your legs or use hair removal creams for 10 days before surgery. This goes back to the risk of infection. They are very, very careful about the risk of infection. So no nicks, cuts, rashes. Now we're up to the week before surgery. And 7 days before surgery, you need to stop all over-the-counter vitamins and supplements, including vitamin E, fish oil, turmeric. You also need to stop any non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, which includes aspirin. And so the reason is these medicines can thin your blood. And so this is one of the things that we ask you to do to help cut down on blood loss. And I did say at the beginning that non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs are one of the things that we use to help arthritis pain. And we realize a lot of our patients do take these medications and that you will probably have increased pain when you stop them 7 days before surgery. But it's really important to do that. And if you need something for pain that week, it's okay to take Tylenol or the generic acetaminophen because it does not thin your blood. There are other blood thinning medicines like Eliquis, Plavix, Xarelto, Coumadin. If you take one of these medicines, they're prescribed for different reasons. And so this would be one of the times that you'll probably be asked for a clearance. You would see the doctor who prescribes it, let them know you're scheduled for hip replacement surgery. They will tell you how many days ahead of time to stop taking this medication. Sometimes arthritis patients take prednisone. Now, prednisone is not a blood thinner, it's a steroid. But it can slow healing, increase your risk for infection. So if you take prednisone or steroids, your surgeon prefers that you be off of it before surgery. If that's not possible, then the lowest dose possible. So again, you would work with the doctor who prescribes it because depending on the dose you're on and how long you've been on it, you might not be able to stop it suddenly. It might have to be tapered off. And then if you take medicines for rheumatoid arthritis, lupus, or other autoimmune disorders, if you've not already discussed with your surgeon or the joint replacement nurse coordinator, please call my number that's on the card in the front of your folder so that And let the joint replacement nurse coordinator know so that she can go over the protocol with you and let you know if the medicine needs to be stopped, and if so, how many days before surgery. Now, if you have any open areas, wounds, scratches, rashes on your operated leg, please call my number at least 2 to 3 days before surgery so we can let your surgeon know. Don't wait and come to the hospital the day of surgery. I've seen that happen, and it's very upsetting to patients when they're all psyched up for surgery. They have all their plans in place to be told, because of the possibility of infection, we need to delay surgery for a while. So if you have any questions about open areas, please call ahead of time. Now, the surgeons have me put operated leg on the slide, but I can tell you they're concerned about open areas elsewhere as well. So if you have any concerns about open areas, please call my number. Because again, infection, if it's infected or might get infected, that could possibly spread to the hip replacement, and we wouldn't want that to happen, and they're very, very careful about the risk of infection. Now, 2 days before surgery, your surgeon wants you to start taking extra strength Tylenol, or the generic acetaminophen is fine, every 6 hours, scheduled. This is part of our pain management protocol. And a couple of cautions about Tylenol. You cannot drink alcohol while you're taking Tylenol because it can cause severe liver problems, which obviously we don't want you to have. The other caution about Tylenol is it's a medicine that if you get too much of it, it can damage your liver. So the current recommendation is no more than 4,000 milligrams of Tylenol per day. This is 2,000 milligrams, but sometimes our patients take medicine that has Tylenol in it, either for their hip problem or maybe for other health problems. So if you already take one of these medicines, you need to figure out how much Tylenol you're taking a day. If this would put you over 4,000 milligrams, you need to cut back somewhere, because obviously we don't want you to have liver problems. Another medication that your surgeon wants you to start taking 2 days before surgery is a stool softener to help head off problems with constipation. So we use docusate sodium, 250 milligrams once a day. Both of these medications are over the counter. And then the day before surgery, you will receive a call from the hospital between 11 and 2 telling you what time to arrive at the hospital the day of your surgery. So the surgeons start working at 7:30. The first case will have to be here at 5:30, 2 hours ahead of time. And then even though they work all day, we have our patients arrive very quickly after 5:30. Usually every 30 to 60 minutes, we have someone arriving. We like to get you here, get you ready for surgery, so that if there is a cancellation, they can keep working. So you will probably have to be here fairly early in the morning, even though your surgery might not be until later in the day. And then that evening, you need to shower following the pre-op bathing instructions in your folder. It's one sheet of paper and it's all spelled out. This is another thing that helps to decrease the risk of infection. So you shower with your regular soap, rinse it off, shampoo your hair, rinse it off. And then everyone should have received 4 packets of HibiCleanse, which is an antibacterial soap. So you'll use 2 packets in the evening, and you start by washing the hip having surgery and then the rest of your body from the neck down. Once you do that, you leave it on 5 minutes, then after 5 minutes, you rinse it off completely, dry with a clean towel, put on clean clothes, clean sheets on your bed. And then after midnight, the night before surgery, no food, including candy, gum, and breath mints. You cannot smoke, vape, or use any nicotine or tobacco products. And if those instructions aren't followed, then it's likely that your surgery will be canceled. So the day of surgery, before you come to the hospital, you're going to shower again following those instructions. As I just described, you'll use the other two packets of HipaCleanse, leave it on 5 minutes again, then you'll rinse it off, dry with another clean towel, clean clothes to come to the hospital. That morning, you can drink 6 to 8 ounces of water, tea, or coffee without sugar in sugar or milk in either of them until you leave your home. And then after you leave your home, nothing to eat or drink. You should wear clean, loose, comfortable clothes and bring a pair of shoes or slippers with an enclosed heel. Sandals or flip-flops are easy to get tripped up on after you've had surgery. So to help avoid falls, you need a pair of shoes or slippers with an enclosed heel. And then bring loose, comfortable clothes to wear in the hospital. Now, when you came to your pre-admission testing appointment, if the pre-admission testing nurse told you to take some of the medicines that you currently take the morning of surgery, then you can do that with a sip of water before you leave home. You can brush your teeth, but don't swallow the water. And then you should not wear any makeup, jewelry, body piercings, or nail polish. All body piercings have to be removed, and any rings that won't come off will have to be removed. So it's much better if you take care of this before you leave your home than wait until you get to the hospital and then us have to deal with it. Okay, so what to bring with you? Bring your blue folder with your booklet, a list of the medicines that you're taking, and then a list of any questions that you might have whenever you get here. Bring your picture ID, proof of insurance. If you wear dentures, bring your dentures with you. You should wear your eyeglasses if needed. Don't wear contact lenses. And then don't bring any jewelry, valuables, large amounts of money. We don't lose things very often, but sometimes things do get misplaced. So if something is really important to you or valuable, the safe thing is to leave it at home. And then if you have advance directives, powers of attorney, or legal guardianship papers, bring a copy of those so we can put them on your chart as well. So it's very important that you arrive on time. If you don't, your surgery might be delayed or canceled. Your family can drop you off at the main entrance, then they'll park in the hospital parking garage. You will have to register, so let them know at the information desk that you're here for surgery. They'll send you to registration. Once you're registered, you'll get directions to the surgery waiting room. So if you already use equipment like a walker, a cane, or a brace, if you need them to come into the hospital, then that's fine. If not, leave them in the car and your family can bring them to your room on the sixth floor after surgery. So once you're registered, go to the surgery waiting room. From there, you're going to go to the pre-op holding room. This is where you get ready for surgery. First thing the nurses do is check your vital signs, your blood pressure, pulse, temperature, make sure there are no problems there. They'll ask you to change into a hospital gown. They'll start an IV. They place heart and oxygen monitors. You will get medications both through your IV and by mouth in the holding room. The nurses will swab your nose with iodine. This helps to prevent infection. It helps prevent MRSA, which stands for methicillin-resistant staph aureus. If you happen to be allergic to iodine, call my number tomorrow morning. Let us know. We have a different protocol that we'll get you on to help prevent MRSA. You will see your surgeon in the holding room. He has to mark the correct hip that's being operated on. And you'll see the anesthesiologist. He will talk to you about the type of anesthesia that you'll have for surgery. and that will either be a general anesthesia or spinal anesthesia. General anesthesia is where you're put to sleep. They'll put a tube down your throat, support your breathing through surgery. Tube comes out before you wake up, either in the operating room or the recovery room. I wouldn't mention it except that lots of times patients either later that evening or the morning after surgery complain of a sore throat, and that's from the tube down their throat. Spinal anesthesia is where they put a needle between the vertebrae in your back. They inject medicine that numbs you from the waist down, and they can actually do hip replacement surgery under spinal anesthesia if they decide that's the safest anesthesia for you. You won't be awake during surgery to hear what's going on in the operating room. What they'll do is give you medicine through your IV, relaxes you, you sleep through surgery, but it's not a deep enough sleep that they would need to support your breathing like they do with general anesthesia. The spinal anesthesia does not interfere with your activity. You will still be able to get out of bed the day of surgery. They do ask that one family member or friend be in the waiting room while you're in the operating room. Surgery lasts about an hour and a half. We give ourselves a range because everyone's individual, 1 to 3 hours. The nurses in the operating room will call out and let your family know how surgery's going. And then when surgery's over, you will go to the recovery room or the post-anesthesia care unit. And the surgeon will go out and talk to your family in the waiting room and let them know how surgery went. So, as you wake up in the recovery room, you will still have your IV. You'll have oxygen. Oxygen helps with healing, helps with your breathing. Depending on how you're breathing, you might wear that upstairs on the sixth floor for a little while. The heart and oxygen monitors will be removed as your vital signs are stable. If you have a urinary catheter in your bladder, and it is up to the surgeon to decide whether or not to use a urinary catheter, that will be taken out later the day of surgery or the morning after surgery. And then as you wake up, you might be aware of a knee immobilizer on your operated leg, which is in the picture on the left. It's a brace that goes on your operated leg. It Velcros on. It has metal in it that keeps you from bending your knee. Or you might have an abduction pillow between your legs as pictured on the right, the big triangle shaped pillow that's Velcroed on. Now, both of these are supposed to be there because one of the other possible complications after hip replacement surgery is dislocation, or that's where your hip pops out of the socket. So when you're waking up from anesthesia is one of the times when you might make some movement that causes your hip to dislocate, like bend your knee up too far or flop your leg over. And so the purpose of the knee immobilizer and the abduction pillow, that's the reminder as you wake up not to do one of those movements that might cause your hip to dislocate. Physical therapy is going to talk more about knee immobilizer and abduction pillow later on in class. And then our pain management continues in the recovery room. So the goal of pain management is to control your pain. Your surgeon wants you to know that you should expect to have some pain as you heal. And we use oral pain medications, and we use multiple medications that work different ways to control pain. And there's a chart in your booklet about some of the medicines that we use and how they work. We try to decrease the amount of narcotics needed because patients have come back and told us they don't like the way narcotics make them feel, and then the problems with constipation that we've talked about that are very common after orthopedic surgeries. We do prescribe narcotics if needed, but we try to decrease the amount needed. So if you take narcotic medicine already, like I mentioned a little while ago, your surgeon wants you to know that this can make it harder to control your pain after surgery. So, you know, if you're already used to taking narcotics, it can make it harder to control your pain. That is another reason that he would like you to stop taking them, or at least decrease the amount you take before surgery. When you're discharged from the hospital, you will get a chart that shows the discharge meds that you're prescribed and when to take them. The some of the medicines are scheduled, like every 4 hours or four times a day or three times a day. The narcotics are usually prescribed as needed. You know, there'll be instructions, one tablet every 4 to 6 hours or every 8 hours as needed. And everyone takes them individually because everyone's pain is individual. So either you or your coach need to keep up with how you're taking them. And if you start to run low and think you need a refill, you need to call the office at least 3 business days ahead of time. Don't wait until you're down to the last 1 or 2 pills and it's a Friday afternoon, because we might not be able to help you until the following week. You have to give your surgeon time to respond to those requests. So most patients leave the day of surgery or the day after surgery. Upstairs on the 6th floor, our orthopedic unit, we have a nurse practitioner who will see you the day of surgery and then the day after surgery. She works with your surgeon to make decisions about your care, decisions about your discharge. You will have registered nurses who are responsible for your care 24 hours a day. And then we also have nursing care technicians who work under the supervision of the registered nurses. So I wanted to let you know that the whole process of surgery, from the time you leave the waiting room, get ready for surgery, go through recovery room, could take 4 or 5 hours. And like I said, the nurses in the recovery room will let your family know what room you're going to upstairs on the 6th floor so they can be there when you get there. So your IV fluids will run overnight, and then the morning after surgery, the nurses will come in, they'll unhook the tubing, they cap the little catheter that goes in the vein, they flush it with saline, normal saline, to keep it open. That'll free you up. No one has to drag the IV pole with you anymore when you're walking to the bathroom with the nursing staff or walking in the hallway with physical therapy. And then before your discharge later in the day, they'll take the little catheter out of the vein. Like I mentioned earlier, if you have a urinary catheter in your bladder, they take it out either the evening of surgery or early the morning after surgery, usually by 6 o'clock. We don't leave them in long because of the risk of infection. Okay, so before you can go home, you need to show that you can use a walker to walk 150 feet. We consider that like normal household distances, so that you can get into your house, get to the bathroom, living room, kitchen. You need to show that you can move, follow your hip precautions if needed, and physical therapy. We'll talk about hip precautions later on in class. You need to show that you can do things to take care of yourself, like walk to the bathroom on your own, and then have no fever or any other complications after surgery. In the hospital, we have a nurse case manager. She'll review your discharge plans with you, make final arrangements for any equipment that you need. Our patients are using a walker, like the one in the picture when they leave, the ones with the 2 front wheels. So if you don't already have one, she will order one for you It will be delivered to your room and you'll take it home with you. And then if there's any other equipment that you need, that will be discussed with you as well. The nurses upstairs on the sixth floor wanted me to tell you that it can take several hours after you're told that you're being discharged for you to actually be ready to leave the hospital. They ask that you be patient with them. They will get you out as quickly as possible, but they tell me that most of our patients leave between 1 and 3 in the afternoon. So other services that we have at the hospital, you've already met one of our dietitians. We do have a chaplain. I've mentioned the nurse case manager. Pharmacy has a program they call Meds to Beds. So in the front lobby, when you came in, I don't know if you noticed, there is a retail pharmacy there. They can fill your discharge prescriptions for you if you want them to. And how that works is the nurses will send your discharge prescriptions down to them. They will fill them, call your room with the information about your copay and how you're going to pay it. And then they'll bring your discharge medicines to your room before you leave. So it's a nice service they offer. If you want to do that or see any of these people, let your nurse know. She can take care of it for you. Now, one of the questions that I frequently get asked is, if I get my discharge medicines filled there and I need a refill, do I have to come back to the Good Samaritan Pharmacy to get them? And the answer to that question is no. Refills can be sent to whatever pharmacy you ask us to send them to. You just need to make sure that we have the correct information in your chart when you call for a refill. So some general information about the hospital. Visiting hours are 8 a.m. to 9 p.m. You're allowed 2 visitors at a time, unless we're under flu or COVID-19 restrictions. Good Samaritan Hospital is all private rooms, so it is okay with the nursing staff if someone stays overnight with you. Now, they don't have to, but if someone wants to stay or you want someone to stay, it is okay with the nursing staff. Okay, so when you go home, a little bit more about preventing infection. I told you it's one of the possible complications after hip replacement surgery. We've talked about showering, how incisions are closed. So once you have your hip replaced, anytime after that that you see a doctor or dentist, you need to let them know that you've had a hip replacement. Because you might need antibiotics before invasive procedures. So your responsibility is to let them know that you have had a hip replacement, and then they will decide, based on their knowledge of the procedure they're doing, the risk of infection, do you need antibiotics? And if so, they will prescribe them. Now, if you think you're getting an infection in your operated hip, your surgeon wants you to call us. This would be another time that you would call my number that's on the card in the front of your folder. And I will go over the signs of infection that you'll look for. Nurses will do this again. They'll review these again before you leave the hospital. So you will look at your incision for redness, especially redness that goes out on the skin away from the incision. Drainage, especially drainage that looks like pus or greenish type drainage. Increased pain or swelling around the incision, fever, chills. If you have any concerns about any of these, please call my number. And like I said, if it's after hours or on the weekend or a holiday, the message on my number tells you how to get a hold of the orthopedic doctor on call if you really need to talk to someone. Now, if you suspect that you have an infection elsewhere, that would be when you call your family doctor or your dentist. So something like a sinus infection or a bladder infection. Then you can see your doctor or go to a local clinic. Now, another possible complication after hip replacement surgery. I've talked about infection, I've talked about dislocation. So a third possible complication is blood clots. And the issue here is, normally it's the muscles in our legs that keeps the blood circulating back to our heart. So when you're laying on the operating room table, you're laying in bed, maybe not moving around as much as normal, blood flow can slow down and possibly clot, and then blood clots can be very dangerous. So we do lots of things to help prevent blood clots. One of the first things that you can do as you wake up in the recovery room is ankle exercises. And physical therapy is going to show you ankle exercises later in class. And then this is something that your coach can remind you to do later on. Early ambulation. We get our patients up moving very quickly. You will be out of bed the day of surgery to help prevent blood clots and other complications after surgery. And then you will have SCDs. You'll hear the staff talk about, I'm going to put your SCDs on. Stands for sequential compression device. And you can see in the picture, it's the two wraps that go around your lower leg are attached to that machine sitting on the floor, and then it intermittently inflates a bladder in the back of that wrap that squeezes those calf muscles, helps with the circulation. So this is only in the hospital. You do not go home with these, but they need to be on any time that you're not walking. So if you're laying in bed or sitting in the chair, the SCDs need to be on to help prevent blood clots. And then we ask that you don't fly or take long car trips for 6 weeks after surgery. So a long car trip would be anything over an hour. And we realize that a lot of our patients might have to travel further than that to get home from the hospital or back for their follow-up appointments. So if you do have to take a long car trip, what your surgeon wants you to do is get out. Okay, so he wants you to stop every hour, get out and walk for 10 or 15 minutes. Makes for a longer trip, but it helps to prevent blood clots and stiffness. Flying is a little bit more difficult, but we realize things happen and sometimes people do have to fly within that first 6 weeks. If that's the case, you need to call our office, because what I have seen is that usually they will put patients on a blood thinning medicine like Xarelto or Eliquis around the time they fly, like maybe the day before, the day of, and the day after they fly. So if you have to fly in the first 6 weeks after surgery, please call our office, let your surgeon know. And then everyone is on medicine to prevent blood clots after surgery. And depending on your risk factors for getting a blood clot, you will either be on a baby aspirin twice a day for 4 weeks, or if you're high risk, either Xarelto or Eliquis, which are oral anticoagulants, or Lovenox, a blood thinner shot. So I will tell you what the risk factors are that your surgeon looks at, but he makes the decision definite the day of surgery of what medicine you'll be on to prevent blood clots. So what he looks at is, and you can kind of think about where you fall, but have you or a family member had a blood clot in the past, or do you or a family member have a bleeding or clotting disorder? Do you take hormones and have not stopped them for a month before surgery and a month after? Or do you have cancer, or have you been treated for cancer in the last 3 months? So any one of those risk factors would put you in the high-risk category, and you would either be on Xarelto, Eliquis, or possibly a blood thinner shot. You also have to be able to take aspirin, and if you can't take aspirin, that would get you into the high-risk category, where you would get Xarelto, Eliquis, or possibly the blood thinner shot. So a little bit about feeling blue or down in the dumps. This is a major surgery, and it's normal to feel down in the dumps or depressed after a major surgery. We don't see this in everyone, but we see it in enough patients that the surgeons ask me to talk about it in class, let you know if it happens to you, it is normal. And what patients tell us is it goes away when they can do more things for themselves. So even though I've told you, you will be up walking around your house, walking to the bathroom, kitchen, living room, it can take more effort right after surgery, and sometimes this gets people down. If this happens to you, if it doesn't get better as you get better, then you need to let someone know. You could let your family doctor know, or you could also let us know so that we can get you some help. So at home, your surgeon wants you to continue the exercises you're taught in the hospital, and physical therapy is going to go over some exercises here in a few minutes. He wants you to walk and gradually increase your activities daily. This goes back to what I talked about at the beginning of class, about getting back to the activities that you might be limited in now. The key word here is gradually. We can't give you a chart that says walk this far by this time, do this activity by this time, because everyone doesn't fit into a chart. And so you are the one who has to pace yourself and do a little bit more each day. You can overdo it. That can actually be a setback, and we have to pull you back a little bit, say take it easy, and then start all over. So do a little bit more each day. Walk a little bit further each day so that you don't overdo it. We want you to keep your feet elevated when you're sitting. That helps decrease swelling, decrease pain, decrease your risk for blood clots. You cannot submerge your incision in water until your doctor says so. So this is different than showering. Showering, the water's running off, but this would be actually like sitting in a bathtub, getting in a swimming pool or a hot tub. And the issue here is if there are any open areas on your incision, bacteria floating around in the water could possibly cause infection. So the guideline is your incision has to be completely healed before you can submerge it in water. And what they mean by that is all the scabs gone. And we say the guideline is about 4 weeks, but I know I've had patients, it's taken longer than that for all the scabs to be gone from their incision. So that's another thing that's individual. Hip precautions, if you need to do them, are for 6 to 8 weeks after surgery, and you will get instructions about that when you're in the hospital if you need to follow them. If you need to use the knee immobilizer and or abduction pillow when you're sleeping for 6 weeks after surgery, you will get instructions in the hospital as well. And then we want you to gradually return to doing things for yourself, household chores, trips away from home. We don't really put limitations on people as far as these things, but the key word here again is gradually. You can't overdo it, and so you have to use good judgment and make sure it's not too far to walk, too long to be gone, too many steps to go up and down so that you overdo it and then have a setback. So the key word is gradually. And then we have guidelines for driving. First one is you have to be off narcotics, and then you have to be off the walker. Your outpatient physical therapist will tell you when you can progress from the walker to a cane. And then if it's your left hip that's being replaced, you might be able to drive sooner than if it's your right hip. If it's your right hip, it's a muscle strength issue, and you have to use good judgment about when you can safely operate a vehicle. We always have to use good judgment about when we can safely operate a vehicle. And what I tell patients to do is go to an empty parking lot and try it. Make sure that you're safe before you get out on a busy highway. We say, again, about 4 weeks, but of course that is individual. And then your follow-up appointments. Your first appointment is going to be 2 to 3 weeks after surgery. Usually at that appointment you see a nurse practitioner or a physician assistant. They'll check your incision, generally see how you're doing, And then at 6 weeks, you'll see your surgeon, have an x-ray, make sure that no problems are developing. And then usually they see patients at 1 year and then every 5 years. Your surgeon is happy to see you if you develop any problems with your hip, though, at any time after surgery. You would just need to call our office. They are happy to answer questions. I do think it's helpful, though, to patients and the surgeon, when you come back for your follow-up appointments, write your questions down so you can go over your list while you have their attention and you don't leave and then think, oh, I forgot to ask about something. Okay, so physical therapy is going to review physical therapy and occupational therapy after hip replacement surgery.
Hello, my name is Robbie Hollemeyer. I will be talking to you about the PT and OT expectations following hip replacement surgery. So first is an overview. Physical therapists will be assisting you with exercises, mobility, and reviewing your total hip precautions if necessary. Occupational therapy will be helping you perform daily activities, things like dressing, bathing, and toileting, and again, reviewing your total hip precautions if necessary. Combined, physical therapy and occupational therapy will help identify any equipment needs that you have as a standard that is covered by insurance. Each patient, if you don't already have one, will receive a walker. Again, that'll be covered by insurance and will be delivered to the hospital before you're discharged. As far as other equipment needs, it will depend on your physical abilities and also the type of hip precaution that you may or potentially may not have. Also, physical therapy and occupational therapy work together to make discharge recommendations from the hospital. In terms of preparation now for this class, go ahead and plan on being discharged home from the hospital. The only time that would change is if there is an unexpected medical condition that occurs during surgery or after surgery that would require ongoing physician and or nursing care, in which case we would recommend an inpatient rehab hospital so that you could be seen by a physician, have ongoing nursing care, but then also see physical therapy and occupational therapy during your stay at that inpatient rehab facility. So total hip precautions, basically they're just rules to follow after hip replacement to avoid dislocation. These total hip precautions are usually anywhere 6 to 8 weeks in length, so it's not a lifelong precaution. It's just there to allow proper healing time. And then after that has occurred, your physician will then tell you you can proceed with activities of life as normal, and you don't have to follow those hip precautions anymore. So we're going to review those, starting with posterior hip precautions. This is just named because the incision site on your hip is further back towards your buttock. There are three hip precautions. The first one is not to bend your hips past 90 degrees. So just like the picture shows with the torso and the hips, make a 90 degree angle. So we don't want you to lean forward like you're tying your shoe or to bring your knee up toward your towards your chest like you're tying your shoe, because again, that would break that 90 degree angle. We also don't want you bending over to pick things up from the ground, because again, you'd be breaking that 90 degree angle. As a general rule of thumb, we tell patients anytime you're reaching your hands past your knees, you're probably breaking that 90 degree angle. So that's just a good cue for most patients to follow. The second one is not crossing your legs past midline. So just like the picture shows, that means you can't cross at your knees or at your ankles. Again, the picture shows a seated position, but this also applies to when you're lying in bed. Again, you can't cross your legs, whether it's at your knees or at your ankles. And then the third one is we don't want you to turn your toes inward. Your toes should always be pointed straight up, like in the case if you're lying in bed, or straight forward in the case where you're walking. Most often, this applies in this type of situation as far as meal preparation. So we don't want your feet stationary and rotating at your hips, but think about it as being more robotic, that every time you turn your shoulders, your feet should also turn with them. So we don't want your feet planted and then just pivoting or rotating at your torso, because this would be the same as the toes turn inward. So in review, the three posterior hip precautions. First, not bending your hips past 90 degrees. Second, not crossing your legs past midline. Again, that's both at the knees and at the ankles. And then third, not turning your toes inward. Depending on your surgeon, they may have you wear a knee immobilizer and or a hip abduction pillow when you're in bed. Again, this would be for the 6 to 8 week duration of those hip precautions. Again, just to make you safe. The second type of surgical intervention is anterior hip. So again, it's just named because the incision site is more forward on your hip. There are two precautions to follow with this type of procedure. The first one is no forced hip extension. So like the picture shows, the left leg would be the surgical leg. So we just don't want you taking big strides when you're walking, or if you're trying to like stretch out your leg or your thigh, we don't want that to be in an extended position. So you can walk normally. We just don't want you taking over exaggerated strides. The second one is no external rotation. So like the picture kind of shows, we refer to this as a figure four position, but you wouldn't be able to slide your foot up along your knee like you were going to tie your shoe to where that surgical leg, in this case would be right leg, is kind of in that bent figure four position. So we want you to avoid that external rotation. So as we move forward to physical therapy and what to expect on your hospital stay, physical therapy will see you the day of surgery. On that first visit, we will review total hip precautions as they apply to your particular procedure. We will instruct you in leg exercises, which we will go over here in just a minute. We will have you take a short walk of 25 feet. And the pattern is to advance the walker first and then to step with your operated leg first and then your non-operated leg. So by taking that short walk, it'll help you get used to that pattern, but also help you get used to navigating that walker, because for many of you, you may have not walked with a walker before. And then last, we have you sit up in a recliner for at least 2 hours. And this is to help improve your airway clearance. So it helps you recover from anesthesia. And whoever your coach is here with you, we will review all these things so they can reiterate them at home. Physical therapy will continue to see you twice a day, once in the morning, once in the afternoon, for as long as you stay at the hospital. With those sessions, our goals are to advance the walking distance to at least 150 feet. This way, the surgeons are comfortable knowing that once you do go home, you should be able to get up to go to the bathroom or go to the kitchen to get something to eat or drink. So just those normal household distances. We'll have you enhance your exercise. And we give you a new packet while you're here at the hospital. It actually has 4 weeks worth of exercises in it. So we will review the first week with you so that you will do those at home until you have that first outpatient physical therapy appointment. At that point, we encourage everyone to take the packet with them, because then that physical therapist at the outpatient clinic can see, based on the surgeon's recommendations, how aggressive to progress you in the subsequent weeks. So this packet just also serves as a template. Again, that outpatient physical therapist doesn't have to follow those exercises to a T, but it just gives them a good idea of how aggressive to be with you. Third, we'll have you practice steps. So if you have any steps to get in your house or within your house, we will practice those here at the hospital. The pattern is to take one step at a time. When you go up the step, we want you to advance your good leg or your non-surgical leg first. When you come down the steps, we want you to advance your bad leg or your surgical leg first. So we use the term up with the good, down with the bad. And again, whoever your coach is here with you at the hospital, they will We will reiterate all these points to them so that they can help you carry those forward at home. So reviewing the exercises, we do encourage you to perform these. Research has shown that improved range of motion and improved strength before surgery improves your outcome after surgery. Just be aware that with these exercises, we do encourage you to do them 2 to 3 times a day, anywhere between 20 and 30 reps for each exercise. But obviously you're coming or you're attending class today because you're gonna be having surgery. So if any of the exercises give you excruciating pain, don't try to push forward and try to do the 20 reps or 30 reps. If you can only do 5 repetitions, or if you can only do 10 repetitions, then that's still better than nothing. So the first 3 exercises we will go over are the exercises that we do the day of surgery. It's important to start these exercises now, just to develop a little bit of muscle memory, because day of surgery, typically you're gonna be tired or groggy from all the medicine and anesthesia. So by doing it now, it will help develop the muscle memory, because these exercises are crucial to increase blood flow circulation through your legs and decrease your risk of blood clots. So these exercises are pretty straightforward and simple. They shouldn't cause pain before surgery or after surgery, but again, just important to increase that blood flow. So the first one is ankle pumps. Just the picture shows you're just pumping your foot forward and backward, just in a nice, smooth, rhythmical fashion. The second one, quad sets. So you're just pushing your knees down flat into whatever surface you're either sitting or laying on, and you'll feel the muscles on the top of the thighs tighten. We want you to hold that for 3 to 5 seconds. And then third, glute sets. So we just want you to tighten your buttock muscles. Again, hold 3 to 5 seconds. The next set of exercises, again, we encourage you to do, but if they're putting you in excruciating pain, do what you can, but the goal is 20 to 30 reps, 2 to 3 times a day. So the first one, short arc quads. The picture shows a ball under the knee, but you can also, you know, fold up a pillow or roll up a towel, just something firm under your knee. And then you're just extending your lower leg up towards the ceiling. The second one, heel slides lying down. Just like the picture shows, we want you to lay down. The important part is always to keep your heel in contact with the surface. To make it easier for you, we encourage you to use a belt or like a bed sheet, put it around your foot in like a loop fashion, hold on to it with both of your hands, and that way your arms can help control as you bend that knee and slide that heel towards you and also push away from you. So basically reduce the stress on your leg and puts a little bit more of the workload through your arms. Long arc quads, so you don't have to wear an ankle weight like the picture shows, but just by sitting in a chair and again extending that lower leg up towards the ceiling, at the very top you'll feel your quad muscles kick in. Then we also encourage you to do some upper body exercises. Again, using that walker will require a little bit of upper body strength and coordination, but most importantly, after surgery, your leg is going to be painful, so you're going to be less inclined to push through your leg when you're trying to go from a sitting to a standing position. So you're going to depend a lot more on your arms in order to push your body weight up from that seated position. So the first one we encourage you to do is just bicep curls. So just like the picture shows, we encourage use a weight anywhere 5 to 10 pounds. So we want lighter weight, but again, to where you're doing it for more repetitions, 20 and 30, as opposed to using, say, a 30 pound weight and only being able to do 5 repetitions. So again, 5 to 10 pounds, so lightweight, more reps. The second one simulates just what we talked about, but seated press ups. So we want you to use your legs as little as possible and really push through your arms to again simulate what it's going to be like after surgery to go from that seated to standing position. So this helps us transition to occupational therapy. They will see you the day after surgery. Again, they're going to review those total hip precautions as necessary, depending on your situation. They will introduce adaptive addressing equipment. This will be only for the case of posterior placement or posterior hip precautions. And they will practice activities of daily living, such as dressing, bathing, and toileting, to make you as independent as possible. So this slide shows full equipment that you should consider purchasing before surgery because it's not covered by any type of insurance. So the picture to the left is a shower, which is designed to use in a stand-up shower. Picture to the right is a tub bench. Just like the picture shows, you want to put two legs inside the tub, two legs outside the tub, and that way you can just sit and scoot your butt across. Basically, this avoids you having to pick your leg up and over the tub, which for some situations you could catch your toe and then actually fall into the tub. And again, we want to help you try to avoid any kind of trip hazards or any kind of safety risk. The other reason we encourage you to purchase these is because after surgery, you're going to be taking pain medication. The side effects of that often for most patients is dizziness and lightheadedness, but combined with a warm shower often leads people to pass out. So in order to mitigate those symptoms, we encourage you to be in a seated position. We also encourage you to have somebody there with you the first couple times that you do bathe, because again, if you do feel lightheaded or dizzy, then that person can tend to you right away, as opposed to you passing out and then you're left there for an unknown period of time by yourself. Other helpful items that you purchase before surgery: long-handled bath sponge, long-handled shoehorn, and elastic shoelaces. So these items, as well as the shower chair or the tub bench, can be found at places such as Walgreens, Walmart, CVS, Lowe's, Home Depot, or you could order them online, places like Amazon and other stores like that. So this slide shows equipment that would be provided and would be covered by insurance, but only in the case of having a posterior hip replacement or having posterior hip precautions. So up top, you have the reacher, below that, the sock aid, and then to the right, the bedside commode. Again, this will allow you to do toileting and dressing as independently as possible. We also encourage the bedside commode because legs are adjustable. So you can use the commode freestanding like the picture shows, or you could take the bucket out and put it over your existing toilet in order to raise the height according to your height so that you're not breaking that 90 degree hip flexion precaution. So other helpful tips from patients, starting with getting in and out of the car. We do recommend a taller vehicle to pick you up from the hospital. While it might be difficult to get in the vehicle, at least getting out of the vehicle, you just slide down to your feet and then walk to wherever it is you're going. Whereas now a lot of four-door sedans sit low to the ground, so it makes it difficult both getting in and out of the vehicle. So if you had a taller vehicle, it makes it at least, you know, 50% easier on you as the patient. We also have had patients having success with using a garbage bag in that passenger seat to help reduce the friction on their butt, which just makes kind of pivoting your legs in and out of the car easier. Like we said at the beginning, definitely plan on being discharged home following surgery. So these are things that you can kind of do to prepare your home to make that transition smoother and safer for you. First, check the height of your chair that you're going to be sitting or spending most of your time in. We do recommend that it's 19 to 21 inches in height, and with armrests that you got something to really push through in order to transition from going to that seated to standing position. Check in the height of your bed. So if you do have a taller bed, we recommend buying a footstool so it makes it easier to get in and out of bed. But if your bed is lower to the ground, we recommend building it up to at least waist level so it makes it easier getting in and out of bed. Removing obstructions and walkways. So this includes any kind of furniture and or throw rugs. So you're going to be using that walker. So the furniture can sometimes be cumbersome to navigate around that. Also, the throw rugs present a trip hazard, especially with using that walker. So these, again, will help increase your safety by temporarily removing those. If you are going to be left home alone for any period of time, we've had patients use a carpenter's apron or put a basket on their walker. So this allows them to carry small items from one place to another, because your hands are going to be occupied on that walker. For obvious reasons, preparing meals and freezing them. Again, you're not going to feel like cooking. So meals that you can easily reheat in the oven or the microwave makes life a little bit easier for you. And then the last two go together as far as with pets. So again, being here at the hospital, your pet is going to miss you. So when you do go home, we recommend that the pet be or on a leash to where they can gradually be reintroduced to you. This is more pertinent if you have a large dog. What we've had instances in the past where the patient comes home, the dog jumps up on them to greet them, patient loses their balance, falls, and they have to come right back to the hospital. So we don't want that to be you. Second part is planning for the care of pets. First, you're going to have an incision site, so that should be covered by a post-operative dressing and then also clothing. But just be aware that for pets, they're inclined to lick their wounds as a way to promote healing. But for us, that presents a risk for infection. So just be aware whether your dog or cat likes to be in your lap, just that they're not, you know, they're going to be curious about that incision site, but just making sure that they're not licking that area or anything like that. Also, in the other case of cats or dogs, if they like to follow you around the house everywhere you go, again, they could present a trip hazard when you're using that walker. So in those cases, we've had patients, whether they have their pet cared for by a neighbor or a family member or the local kennel, but just for a short term until they feel comfortable getting up and getting around, we've had them, you know, temporarily stay away from the house in order to make it safer for you. That concludes my portion. So again, any questions or comments can be directed and we can get you those answers. Thank you.